We want to welcome everyone out to our Wednesday evening worship service. We're so glad that you could join us, whether you're here in person or you're here online. Put your hands together and clap as we begin to lift up the name of Jesus. Praise
is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are turning to you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, welcome you here, Lord Jesus. The sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come out your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
God for every single person in this place tonight. Amen. You lift your burdens upon him. You can cast them upon him and he can answer and he can move tonight. So we lift our voices and we say,
I'm praying God come and turn this thing around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Calling on the name, yeah, it changes everything. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. All of my hope is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. I'm praying, God, come. Whoa. Turn this thing around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Calling on the name changes everything. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. All of my turn it around. God, turn it around. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. Right now. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. Right now. Making way for someone. God is doing something right now. Right now. He is moving mountains. Making way for someone. God is doing something right now. Right now. He is moving mountains. Making way for someone. God is doing something right now. Right now. He is moving mountains. Making way. Turn it around, God, turn it around, God, turn it around.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, let me praise you.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord. You are holy.
Jesus, you are holy.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus, you are holy. And I praise your name.
Jesus, precious Lord.
Jesus, precious Lord.
Send your Holy Spirit.
Send your Holy Spirit.
Jesus, precious Lord.
Jesus, precious Lord.
Send your Holy Spirit. And I praise your
Thomas falls in front of Jesus and says, my Lord and my God, my Lord, my Master. We lift our hands and we just say, you're Lord. That's it. My week has been crazy. Today's been crazy. It's been Wednesday. And you're Lord. And that's all that matters. That's all that has to happen tonight. We go before him. We're going to go before God with a need on our heart. I'm going to pray for our brother Herb Unruh. He needs healing in his body. We need to pray for him and go before God and say, you know what, God, we need you to move on his behalf. We're going to pray for our sister Beth McLaughlin. Her father is has some health issues as well, and she's, I believe, going back to see him. So we need to pray. Who here, you have a need on your heart, saying, you know what, God, I need you to move upon my life. Amen. We're going to go before the Lord with these needs on our hearts. And I'm going to ask Brother Dave Fish to come and open us in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord. We pray right now for our brother Herb Unruh, God. We pray that your grace and your mercy be upon him even now, God. That your healing and your mercy and grace be in his life, God. Lord, we lift up Israel. Father, we pray for your grace and your power, God. I pray for your protection and your mercy, Lord.
Yes, Lord, we thank you, God, and we pray, God, your peace, Lord, upon Israel and upon Jerusalem, God, that you would help the Israeli people tonight. Lord, in all their endeavors, God, you would bring peace to that region. And Lord, we pray, God, bring peace into our own hearts and our own lives. God, our own circumstances at times can seem confusing. Lord, where we do not fully understand this side of heaven, but God, bring your your peace. Bring your grace and your power, God. Lord, move upon those that need healing tonight. Lord, we pray for Brother Herb under God. Lord, touch him right now. Do a miracle in his body. And Lord, we pray, God, Lord, stir us afresh in you and in your word. Lord, bring a blessing into our hearts and our lives, God. Refresh us. Lord, renew us tonight, God. Let us enjoy this wonderful time we have in your presence and with one another. And God, we ask your anointing, Lord, on the preacher and on the word of God afresh. Let it go forth and accomplish your desire. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Go ahead and greet somebody around you. Introduce yourself if you don't know them. If you're with us on live stream, we are so glad to have you tonight on our Wednesday night service. In our Wednesday night service, just want to go through some announcements before we move on with our service tonight. Tomorrow night, 7:30 in Building 1, we do have our Spanish service with Pastor Leonard Gastelum at 7:30. And then Friday night in the Fellowship Hall as well at 7:30 is Vision Unlimited, and that is for middle school and high school. And then also HHM groups, our Bible study groups, are meeting at 7:30 Friday night as well. And if you have any questions about that or want to join a Bible study, you can talk to anybody on staff about that or the information desk up front. And then Friday night at 7 is AO, that is our college group. If you have any questions, you can talk to Eddie, who is playing the drums tonight, and be a part of that. If you're college age, 18 to 24, and you're not part of AO, you really need to be a part of that ministry. It's a powerful, powerful ministry. And then Saturday morning, we do have an outreach at 11 a.m. meeting in the lobby right here, and we're going to be outreaching for our Saturday night concert, which is Saturday at 7 p.m., Music Under the Stars. And also, if you have friends or family members who probably wouldn't come to a regular church service, invite them to our concert at 7 o'clock Saturday night, and praise God. Let's see what God does. Amen. Let's have the ushers come. We're going to take an offering this evening. And I was kind of going through everything that John attributed to John, everything that John wrote. And so I'm getting, you know, get to the book of Revelation as the last of the five attributed to him, and all of a sudden the world starts falling apart. So in the book of Revelation, chapter 6, the third seal is, go, and I looked, and there was a black horse whose rider held a pair of scales, and I heard a sound like a voice from heaven, living thing being saying, 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages, meaning after the rapture, a loaf of bread is going to be a day's wages. And we're seeing things today where in our economy, the inflation, the things that are just, it's just kind of run away. I heard a crazy statistic, I think food prices have risen like 14% just in the last last year here, and like we think things are bad now, right? And we're living here in the good old days where you could buy a loaf of bread for $3.50 with a coupon and your membership at the Kroger store. But what we're giving is we're giving against that day. We're giving against Revelation chapter 4. Because once Revelation chapter 4 hits, it's done. It's over. And then the seals are broken. Red horse comes out. The black horse comes out. And the world economy just implodes. And everything is just done. It's gone. It's over. And as we give, we can look and say, you know what? God, we're not giving towards some pie in the sky thing. We're giving towards now. We're giving to save people right here, right now. And you're watching online. There's some people that are, you know, you're kind of like, I don't know if I want to get saved now. I got to, you don't have a lot of time. You don't have a lot of time. Things are happening very fast. Revelation chapter 4, I heard a loud voice come up here and it was over. And then everything falls apart. And as we give tonight, we know that God is going to spare us from all of those things. We're not going to be a part of that. Actually, we're going to be eating a bunch of free food in the marriage supper of the Lamb for 7 years. It's going to be really nice. And the world economy is going to be falling apart, and everything will be falling apart here on earth. But as we give, we know that, you know what, we're giving to save people from that. We're giving to save them from that. And if they become a part of what God is doing now, they will spare them from things that are to come. Brother Toby, go ahead and pray over the offering this evening.
Holy Spirit is here and His power is real. Anything can happen and it probably will. Something very good, something good is going on around here. There's a light that shines, makes the dark disappear. Power at work, but there's nothing to fear. Something very good, something good is going on around here. This is the church on fire. This is the Holy Spirit place. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name. Let the fire burn in every heart. Light the way, defeat the dark. Let the flame of love burn higher. This is the church. This is the church on fire. Power is real. Anything can happen and it probably will. Something very good, something good is going on around you. There's a light that shines, makes the dark disappear. Power at work, but there's nothing to fear. Something very good, something good is going on around you. This is a church on fire. This is the Holy Spirit place. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name. Let the fire burn in every heart. Light the way, defeat the dark. Let the flame of love burn higher. This is the church. This is the church on fire. Let the fire burn in every heart. Light the way, defeat the dark. Let the flame of love burn higher. This is the church. This is the church on fire.
Webb to the pulpit as he comes to minister.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. It's good to be in the house of God. Amen. Good to be saved on our way to heaven. Hallelujah. In the midst of a world that's going nuts, we can have peace and joy and amen. Have an expectancy of good things to come. Hallelujah. We want to look to the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, turn to Daniel chapter 8. I've had a number of people say they are enjoying working through the book of Daniel. I was this weekend in Denver and Fort Collins preaching, and a 14-year-old girl came up and said, "I'm so enjoying this series on Daniel." You know, it's incredible the impact. I was talking to Pastor Isaiah Trujillo. He's the pastor there. And he said, you know, the reason so many people tune in to Tucson is when COVID hit, Tucson was ahead of the game, and they already had their live stream all together, and while people were scrambling, people from all over the world were tuning in to be able to be ministered to and hear the Word of God, and that influence has increased and had impact, and even the children's ministries and, that are filmed are having impact, and other churches are utilizing them. So we are having impact above and beyond what we even understand. Hallelujah. And that's a wonderful thing. So we're looking at the quest for dominion is the series title that we have for our study in the book of Daniel. And 19 times we find that word dominion in a very short book. And it is a central theme. And our purpose isn't just to have expository teaching where we're just working through a book of the Bible, though we do want to do that. The Word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces, it convicts, and it separates the soul, the things of the natural man, and the spirit, the things of the Spirit of God. It brings separation and helps us to be able to perceive. But, you know, we want to mine out of these scriptures, not just for our understanding's sake. You know, our desire isn't just to produce walking encyclopedias that, you know, are very good at playing Bible trivia and because they know it, but rather to have people that are not professors of knowledge, but possessors of wisdom and understanding that can take this and apply it to their lives in order that they can have dominion, so that they can get an upper hand in life. And as the Bible says, we rule and reign with Christ, and His word empowers us to do that. Amen. What a wonderful thing to have a Bible view of life and to be able to analyze and see through the perspective of Scripture so that we can make right decisions. And amen. Thank God for that. And you know, it's always valuable to read. You know, sometimes you might be reading in the morning your Bible and afterwards you're like, I don't even remember anything I read. Have you ever had one of those days? But it's amazing you're feeding your spirit, and the Holy Spirit can take that at an opportune time and bring it to your attention. And you would be like, wow, I didn't even know that I knew that. But then you can bring it into your life's challenges and circumstances. In chapter 7 and chapter 8, we're going to see that chapter 7 was the last message, but a word that keeps reoccurring is the word horn or horns 22 times in the two chapters. And a horn in the Bible is more than just something that protrudes from the head, like I had removed. It actually is a picture of dominion. And so there are many scriptures that talk about this, like Psalm 75:10, all the horns of the wicked I will also cut off, but the horns of the righteous shall be exalted. Hannah prayed, 1 Samuel 2:1, and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord, my horn is exalted in the Lord. I smile at my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. And so we know that she had an adversary who was opposing and putting her down, but God worked in her life and she gained the upper hand. And so she's rejoicing in that. And so we're talking about a dominion that's not just for men. It's not just for churches. It's for women. It's for children. It's for families. It's for all of us that we can have dominion. And the thought of the horn is the thought of being able to lift up your head. And we know that Psalm 3:3 tells us that he is the lifter, the one who lifts our head up. And he gives us dominion so that we can triumph in life. And we know Deuteronomy says he's designed us to be the head and not the tail, the thinking end, not the stinking end. Hallelujah. So I want to draw your attention. We're just going to kind of work through the scripture rather than read it all at once. We're going to kind of work through the verses, and there's some incredible revelation that comes from Daniel chapter 8. It's written, now if you read the book of Daniel, we don't know that because we read it in English, but the first chapter is in Hebrew, and then in chapter 2, it switches to Aramaic, which was the language of Babylon, and then in chapter 8, it is switching again back to Hebrew, because from here on, the focus mostly is going to be the children of Israel going back into the land of Israel, and events that can that are relevant to them as a nation. And so in chapter 8, we're given a picture. God reveals to Daniel the next 400 years of history. Amen. It's history for us, but for him, it was the future. Hallelujah. And so it's a wonderful thing that God sees the future as history. Amen. He can look and he knows exactly what's going to happen, and he records it, writes it down. We read it like history, but at the time it was written, it was the future. And so this is an incredible thing for apologetics or defense, because there are people that will oppose the Bible and try to mock it and put it down and oppose our faith. But one of the great things we can resort to is the history of the Word of God, the prophecies being fulfilled, and many are yet to be fulfilled. In Amos 3, verse 7, it says, surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals his secret to his servants, the prophets. Everything that God does, he lets people know ahead of time. Amen. What a wonderful gift that is. And we have prophecy. I have amen, a word that was given to me in 2016 by our brother, evangelist Jerry Fussell, and it laid out us moving to Tucson. Amen. It was history, the history that would soon be recorded. And so I can look back and I can see that God had something in mind, and he let the secret be known to a prophet, to someone who moved in the gift of prophecy. And so this is an incredible revelation that God gives to Daniel, and it comes in the form of a vision. How many have ever had a vision? Amen. It's not frequent. I've had one since I've been saved. It would have been, I think, about 1978. We were having a three-day fast, and we were praying around the clock. I was at the church at 3 or so in the morning praying, and as I was there on my face, I saw this, like, an image of a map of the Southwest. Would have been Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, part of California, and that general area. And I saw a few flames of fire, and then the flames of fire multiplied and it became a blaze. Now that was back when we didn't have churches all over the Southwest, but God has poured out his spirit and we've seen some incredible things happen in that region. And so it was God revealing, this is what I'm going to do. So God is speaking to Daniel, and Daniel is God's man, and he's part of God's plan. And so in this vision, it starts by Daniel being transported in the spirit to Shushan, the capital city of Persia, which was going to become the headquarters of the whole empire in probably just about 20 years from this time. So I want to read this with you, beginning in verse 1 and 2. It says, in the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, that's about 551 BC, before Christ, a vision appeared to me, Daniel. He's almost surprised that God would give him a vision. After the one that appeared to me the first time, I saw in the vision, and it so happened while I was looking that I was in Shushan, the citadel, which was in the province of Elam, and I saw in the vision that I was by the river Ulai. Now, Daniel recognizes where he is, though he's there in the spirit. No doubt he had been there before. And I believe it gives us a key to Daniel chapter 3. How many remember when Nebuchadnezzar on his high horse builds an image and commands everyone to bow down to it? We know that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego says, we're not going to bow. They're thrown into the fire. And amen, the angel of God, Jesus, comes as they're in the fire with them. They suffer no harm. And so they are set free. But in that story, Daniel is nowhere to be found. Now, that could be for one of two reasons. One is that he bowed down to the image, but I don't think so, knowing Daniel's character. Can you say amen? Or he was away from the province at the time. And I believe that he was very high up in Nebuchadnezzar's government, and he probably was an ambassador. He was sent on a mission to Persia. And as he's there, he's preserved from that event. But more than that, he makes some very key contacts with Darius and Cyrus, so that when the government falls in Babylon and the Persians take over, he's well connected, and immediately he's put into one of the top positions in the government. No doubt he had made connections previously. He had got to know Darius and Cyrus and some of these. And so they had come to know him and trust him. They knew his character, and they appointed him to this high profile position. And I want to just say that there is a sovereign plan of God. He is working his plan, and he is able to direct us into strategic places at strategic times to accomplish his will and purpose and to advance us, to bring us into dominion in life. How many know that God knows what's going to happen tomorrow and next week and next month and next year? And the things that are happening today sometimes don't seem to fit in what we feel God is calling us to. But he is in his sovereignty guiding and leading. The Bible says that the Lord directs the steps of a good man. He delights in his way. Amen. Psalms 37. God directs steps of people. And he can direct us. And I know that every job that I've ever got has been set up by God incredibly. And I could tell stories. I have told some of the stories. But God was behind the scenes, knowing what I would need in the future, preparing me for that. And I believe that's true for all of us. As we surrender to the will of God, I was, as I said, just in Denver, and the pastor's wife sent a gift to my wife and Gina Trujillo, and so my wife sent her back a thank you, and so we so miss you. And she said, if it wasn't for you going to Salt Lake, we wouldn't be saved. There was a strategic plan. Now, that's 40 years ago, but God had a plan, and us going there was part of that plan. I was talking to Isaiah Trujillo, and he was telling me all the rest of his family, cousins, uncles, they're a disaster. But because they got saved, there's health, there's solidity, they're a strong family, they're serving God. And he said, it's because you guys decided to go to Salt Lake, and the Rubies went after us. Gabe Ruby came. I don't know, how old were you, two or something like that when they arrived? Him and Isaiah became great friends, and this was all part of God's plan. And we're included in that. That's the thing that's important. So what should our response be? Psalm 37, verse 5, commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. You know, when we say, God, here I am, my life belongs to you, I'm committing my way to you, God gets involved and directs us. Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Hallelujah. So I want to look with you at Daniel's vision here in chapter 8. I like what Pastor Warner said on Sunday morning. He said, when you preach on prophecy, it's informationally intensive. And there's a lot of information there, and more than really what we have time to delve into. But it's an incredible story that is laid out before us because Daniel's writing it before it's happened. You and I are reading it after it's happened, and we can verify all the things that took place. The incredible thing about the book of Daniel, as we read it, Daniel chapter 2, we know God gives Nebuchadnezzar a vision of a person, and then that vision aligns perfectly with what Daniel saw in chapter 7, and then we again read it lining up with chapter 8. There's an incredible synchronization that takes place, and God is giving clarity to the people of God so that they can know that they're moving forward in his will, and they can be prepared for all that will come down. And so in this passage, we find the angel Gabriel comes to give Daniel understanding. This is the first appearance in the Bible of Gabriel. Amen. I don't know. I'm going to rejoice to go to heaven one day and sit down with Gabriel. I don't know if they'll have coffee in heaven. I hope so. We'll have a cup of coffee. And you know, I'll begin to ask him about all these things and he'll fill in some details. Hallelujah. But here he is for the first time and he brings an understanding of what this vision means. So the first image that we see, and we're looking at images of the beasts, is the title of this sermon. But I want to look at the first one. I think we have a picture here of a ram. And so the first thing he sees is a ram. Can we put that up? Not a very good looking creature. But I don't think you'd want to mess with one of them. Verse 3, then I lifted my eyes and saw, and there standing beside the river was a ram, which had two horns, and the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher one came up last. I saw the ram pushing westward, northward, and southward, so that no animal could withstand him, nor was there any that could deliver from his hand, but he did according to his will and became great. This is a Persian empire. And we read that in verse 20, as Gabriel explains, the ram which you saw having the two horns, they are the kings of Media and Persia. And so the Medo-Persian Empire took over that area of the world in the day, which was the known world at the time. They went eastward and took the Assyrian Empire all the way into modern day Turkey. They went southward into Egypt and they were able to take Babylon, and it became such an incredible, powerful empire. And so then as he's looking at that, he sees another vision. Can we put the second picture up of the goat? He sees a vision of a goat. Verse 5-7, and I was considering suddenly, a male goat came from the west across the surface of the whole earth without touching the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. Then he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing beside the river, and ran at him with furious power. And I saw him confronting the ram. He was moved with rage against him, attacked the ram and broke his two horns. There was no power in the ram to withstand him, but he cast him down to the ground and trampled him. And there was no one that could deliver the ram from his hand. So verse 21, Gabriel gives insight into who the goat is. And the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. And Greece has more goats than any country in Europe, in that region, that area. The large horn that is between its eyes is the first king. And so there's some characteristics of this goat, because this goat, though smaller than a ram, is able to come and obliterate, trample down completely this ram. And so there are some things here in this goat that gave him dominion, that if we want to have dominion, I think we can learn from these things. Verse 5, it says that he ran without touching the ground. The thought is speed there. Speaks of the speed of the Grecian Empire. And really within 3 years, Alexander the Great, we're going to look at him in a few minutes, was able to overcome the Medo-Persian Empire, which had had dominion for over 200 years, but instantly, quickly. And then we know from chapter 7 that the Greeks were likened to a leopard being a very fast cat. Verse 6 gives us another secret to dominion, and that is ferocity, and ran at him with furious power. You know, there's something when you just go for it, when you give it all that you've got, when you're intense, intensity will bring dominion. So the Greeks were furious. And the reason is that under King Xerxes, the Persians had attacked Greece. And so the Macedonians were upset. They were able to stave off that attack. But it's like, how dare you cross
the sea and attack us. Who do you think you are? You're not going to do that to us. You know, sometimes you just got to get mad at the devil. Amen? It's like, enough is enough. I'm not going to let you run all over my family, my ministry, my country, and destroy it. You know, we're going to fight the good fight of faith, and we're going to rise up in Jesus' name. And then verse 5 gives us another key, and that is visionary leadership. What a blessing. Verse 5, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And this speaks of the vision and the strength of leadership. We're blessed to be part of a fellowship that has good leadership. I would think on Monday we had Pastor Mitchell here ministering, and how, you know, just discerning he is, sensitive he is. I've come to admire him. Pastor Warner, you know, for all the ups and downs and upheavals and various things, rebellions and things, he's stayed a steady course. Amen. We're blessed. We're here. We're strong because visionary leadership. So then we come to the understanding of who this goat is, or at least the horn coming out, and that's a picture of Alexander the Great, the notable goat's horn. Now we have a couple of images here, if we could put them up. There he is. Amen. Needs a nose job, but we have another image. This was a painting from back in those days. Now, probably a good thing he didn't decide to become a model, but amen, what a powerful leader. One of the, you know, not too many people get to have the great added to their name, but he was one. He was an incredible man. Verse 21 says, and the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. The large horn that is between its eyes is the first king. Now, he was the son of Philip, the second king of Macedon, but here he was able to rally the whole Grecian empire and get them behind him and get them moving. He was 13 years old when his father began to see that this guy has leadership. And so he appointed Aristotle to be his tutor. And Aristotle trained him up, and so he was wise beyond his years. And then at the age of 20, when his dad died, he shared his father's vision, which was that, and his dad had spoke about it, to unite the Greeks together against the Persian Empire and to begin to oppose that and to take dominion. And to that end, he was able to marshal a force of 40,000 men, composed primarily of Macedonians and Greeks. He was able to go up against a much larger Persian army and was able to defeat them because of their ferocity, because of their speed. They were able to soundly defeat the Persians. At the river Granicus, he defeated a force there and further skirmishes into Asia Minor. He appoints Greek governors over these regions and areas. In 333, he comes up against the leader of the Persians, Darius III, and he won a major victory, though Darius escaped. But the Persian army, which way outnumbered the Greeks, was in full retreat. From there, he goes to Egypt, and he moves down. As he's moving down, as the scripture says, he comes up against the cities in Syria and Phoenicia and Palestine, and defeats them. Some of them surrendered peacefully, Tyre was a key base for the Persian fleet, and that fleet was destroyed. But Tyre refused to surrender. And so Alexander besieged the city of Tyre for 7 months. After sacking the city, Alexander sold much of the people, the population of that city, into slavery. He went down from there to Gaza. And we know a lot about Gaza today. But they've had their share of trouble over time. And so they resisted for 2 months with the same result is that Alexander overcame them, sold the people into slavery, moves into Egypt and conquers Egypt and assumes the title of Pharaoh. That all happens in a couple of years. And then he moves back to finish his business with the Persian Empire, and within a year's time, he's able to defeat them. He moves on from there to Afghanistan and quickly defeats Afghanistan and takes possession of that. Interesting sidelight was that as Alexander was making his way back from Gaza, he was moving his armies towards Jerusalem. And Jeddua was the high priest at the time. And he heard the news that Alexander and his forces were coming to Jerusalem. And he was distraught. And so he called the people to fast and pray for God's protection. How many know that's a good thing to do when the armies of Alexander are coming against you? But in a dream, God told Jeddua that they should adorn the city, open the gates, put on their finest garments, and go out to meet Alexander as he neared the city. When Alexander approached and saw the multitude of citizens in their finest apparel, and as he approaches the high priest, he comes up and he salutes him. One of his generals thought, "This is very uncharacteristic of you, Alexander." Why, he asked him, did you do that? Well, Josephus, the historian, Jewish historian, records Alexander's reply. He said this, "I did not adore the high priest, but that God who hath honored him with his high priesthood. For I saw this very person in a dream wearing this very priestly dress, when I was at Dios in Macedonia, who, when I was considering with myself how I might obtain the dominion of Asia, exhorted me to make no delay, but boldly to pass over the sea thither, for that he would conduct my army and would give me the dominion over the Persians. Whence it is, they having seen no other in this priestly dress, and now seeing this person in it, and remembering that vision and the exhortation which I had in my dream, I believe that I bring this army under the divine conduct and shall therewith conquer Darius and destroy the power of the Persians, and that all things will succeed according to what is in my own mind." What we see here is that God, in the midst of conflict, can take care of his people. When they look to him, when they're seeking him, all hell might be breaking loose, but God is able to care. Amen. Yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death at times, we fear no evil. Why? Because we have a God who protects and takes care of us. Amazingly enough, after he had reigned about 12 years, Alexander got sick and died in Babylon. So from there, the kingdom was divided into four empires. And so Daniel has a vision of a five-horned sheep. Can we show that? Four horns growing out of that sheep. I don't think I would want to mess with him either. Verse 22, "As for the broken horn and the four that stood up in its place, four kingdoms shall arise out of that nation.
but not with its power. So after Alexander the Great, the Grecian Empire continued on for almost 200 years, but not with its power. There was division and there was disorder initially, but then four kingdoms rose to take the place of what previously had been the Grecian Empire, the Ptolemies in Egypt, the Seleucids in the east. There was the kingdom of Pergamon in Asia Minor and the Macedonian Empire in modern day Greece. But it was the Ptolemies in Egypt that primarily had dominion over Israel, and then the Seleucids that later would take dominion away from the Ptolemies. So that brings us to the next part of the vision, and that is out of this four-horned beast comes another little horn. And this is none other than Antiochus the Fourth. So do we have a picture of him? At least we have a coin with him showing. That's him on the left. And the Greek writing claims that he's Antiochus, a little vision, perspective on what Daniel saw. Verse 9 says, and out of one of them, out of one of the horns, came a little horn which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. The glorious land being Israel, Palestine. So this was none other than Antiochus, and he named himself Epiphanes, or literally the illustrious one, and it's a thought of the godlike one. He was assuming a god position. Well, the people of the day called him Antiochus Epinanes, which means the madman, amen, which is what he was. And so when he had firmly established himself as king, he decided to conquer Egypt, and he was able to capture all the fortified cities of Egypt and plunder the whole land. And then after that, he set his eyes on Judea, Israel, and Jerusalem. In the year 169 BC, after the conquest of Egypt, he marched his great army into Jerusalem. Verse 10 says, and it grew up to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and some of the stars to the ground and trampled them. Now, stars in Scripture can be a picture of angels, but also of the children of Israel. Abraham's promise was that your descendants are going to be like the stars in the sky. Deuteronomy 10:22, your fathers went down to Egypt with 70 persons, and now the Lord your God has made you as the stars of heaven in multitude. And so here is Antiochus, and he comes up against the stars, God's people. And this is the army of God that he opposes and comes against. Well, you can read about that if you delve into the books of 1st and 2nd Maccabees, and they're not part of our Bible, but they do have some historical value. The Catholics put that in their scriptures, but it tells us the history of what was happening in these times. And it tells the story, an appalling story, of two deeply committed Jewish mothers who determined they were going to, against Antiochus's command, they were going to circumcise their infant boys. When Antiochus heard about it, he killed the babies and hung their dead bodies around each mother's neck. Next, he marched the mothers, all their family members, and anyone who had assisted with the circumcision through the streets of Jerusalem up to the highest wall of the city. Then he flung them to their deaths on the rocks below. Within 2 days, he had slaughtered 40,000 Jewish people. So what we're looking at is the spirit of Antichrist. And we're seeing it alive in our day and hour, aren't we? 1,400 people, and not just soldiers defeated in war, but babies, heads cut off, mothers, elderly, brutally murdered
It's a spirit. Pastor Warner preached about that so eloquently. Daniel 8, verse 11, he says, he even exalted himself as high as the prince of the host. Or in other words, he made himself like he was God. And by him, the daily sacrifices that were taking place in the temple that had been rebuilt were taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. This is a forerunner type of the abomination of desolation. We're going to read about that a little more in Daniel chapter 11, but Jesus referred to it in Matthew 24, and he said, you know what, this was just what Daniel spoke of has a greater fulfillment to come in the tribulation period in the end times. So Antiochus canceled all Jewish festivals and he instituted all the Greek festivals. One of these was the celebration of Bacchanalia, which involved the worship of Bacchus, the god of pleasure and wine. God is a holy God, but these gods, not so much. He forced the Jews to observe Saturnalia, which is the worship of the planet Saturn. He installed whores in the temple for worship and celebration. He forbid people to observe the Sabbath. He banned the practice of circumcision. And verse 12 says, because of transgression, or in other words, what kind of opened the door for this to take place is that the people that were there in Jerusalem at the time had started to move away from God and embrace Hellenistic influences. And God says, is that what you want? Then have it to the full. Amen. Romans talks about God giving up people and letting them go their way. We're seeing that in the world today. Verse 12, because of transgression, an army was given over to the horn to oppose the daily sacrifices, and he cast truth to the ground. He did all this and prospered. When the scripture says he cast truth down to the ground, he did that by outlawing the reading of the scriptures and burning every copy he could find of the Torah. Any books of the law that were found were torn up and burned, and anyone caught with a copy of the scriptures was put to death. It goes on, verse 13 and 14. Then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said that a certain one who was speaking, how long will the vision be concerning the daily sacrifices and the transgression of desolation, the giving of both the sanctuary and the host to be trampled underfoot? And he said to me, for 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. Well, when Judas first came in to Israel and took over was December 14th, was the fall of 170 BC, and on December 14th, 164 BC, the temple was claimed again and rededicated. That's celebrated by the holiday coming up, Hanukkah. Amen. I know that the Vigodas celebrate that and observe that because this was a miracle. And we'll read that story in chapter 11, so we're not going to go into it right now. Amen. But God helped people that rose up and took dominion and said, no, we're not going to allow this. We're going to stand against it. And God supernaturally helped them. Now, what we have here in this Antiochus the Fourth, Antiochus Epiphanes is a picture of the Antichrist to come. Amen. And we read about that in verse 23 to 26. Let's read it. And in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their fullness, a king shall arise, having fierce features, who understands sinister schemes. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. There's demonic power, the Satan. Amen. Actually, empowers him. He shall destroy fearfully and shall prosper and thrive. He shall destroy the mighty and also the holy people. Through his cunning, he shall cause deceit to prosper under his rule, and he shall exalt himself in his heart. He shall destroy many in their prosperity, shall even rise against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without human means. Amen. It's Jesus Christ is going to come back and put him down. So at the end of Daniel 8:22, we find there's this transition from Antiochus to the Antichrist that is yet to come. Amen. In his book, The Cashless, Mark Hitchcock writes, there are more than 100 passages of Scripture that describe the Antichrist. Amen. If anything has ever been prophesied, it's what's coming down very soon. Amen. We can know absolutely that things are going to change, and they can change in a very short period of time. How many remember COVID? It was amazing that I remember we're having lunch in Buffalo with the Williams and Tom and Eve Williams. Amen, as we're having lunch there, we're talking, we're going to be sending impact teams. They were just going to be starting. And that was on like March 14th, I think it was. On March 15th, everything closed down. We couldn't send teams. I mean, all of a sudden, and incredibly to me, within a week, I'm driving in Toronto, 8 million people. It's busy. I mean, it's some of the busiest highways in North America, and there's not a soul to be found. As a matter of fact, I texted Pastor Warner this. I said, hey, Pastor Warner, I'm out and driving about, and I feel like I'm in a scene from one of the big three movies. Maybe they weren't so corny after all. I mean, it was like, in no time, the whole world has changed. Amen. Well, my last point is preparation for the future, because Jesus is coming again, and he could come at any time. Things can change in a moment's notice. Matthew 24:44, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. So the needed posture we have is one of readiness. And dominion comes by being ready. Being in tune with the times and knowing what to do. The children of Issachar were wise because they had understanding of the times and knew what Israel ought to do. The day of the Lord is at hand. Amen. The Bible says, repent, be ready, be alert, be awake. If you think Alexander changed the world in 3 years, it's going to happen in a shorter time than that. So 1 Thessalonians 5, as we draw this to a conclusion, says, but concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need I should write to you, for you yourself know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. If there ever was an hour that we need to be alert, that our heads need to be lifted, that we need to be aware of what's happening, that we need to keep our hearts right with God, it's in the day and hour that we live. This is not a day to play with sin. Can you say amen? It's not a day to think about, well, I don't know, I'm not sure if I'm going to be serving God. No, we need to serve God passionately. Be Alexanders. Alert and aware and ready for when the time comes. You know, when people approach me and they say, you know, Pastor, I think I like that woman. I say, well, are you ready? Well, what do you mean? I mean, do you have a place to live? Some people, they didn't have a car. You know, there's like, there was a brother up in Canada who married one of the sisters here. And I'm like, you can't ride her around in Canada in the winter on the back of your bicycle. You better get some stuff ready if you want to be blessed. If you're called to preach, be ready. Get yourself out of debt. Fill yourself with the Word of God. Develop a prayer life so that when the call comes, you're ready to go. Amen. Study to show yourself approved, a workman that needs not reproof. Hallelujah. Let's be alert and about our Father's business. Let's bow our heads together. Every head is bowed. Our eyes are closed just for a moment. As we pause just for a short moment to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. Amen. What an incredible revelation where God tells Daniel, this is what the next 400 years is going to be about. You know, the Bible tells us what eternity is going to be about. And it's God's desire that we make heaven our home. There are many who will not, sadly. And it's not because God wants them to miss heaven. The scripture says he desires that none perish, but that all find a place of repentance. Amen. The decisions we make in this life determine our eternity. Are you ready? Should you die tonight? There's so many accidents in Tucson. Like, I look at the news, and it's like every day people are dying on the streets of Tucson. It's a time to make sure that we're right with God. We're good to go. Amen. The count has been settled. We've turned from our sin. We have peace with God. Can we pray for you this evening if you're here and you're not saved? You say, Pastor, I need to get right with God. God's dealing with me. I want to get saved. If that's you, would you slip up your hand very quickly all over this place in honesty? God's dealing with you. Amen. You want to give your heart to Christ. You're not serving God right now. Amen. You can. Tonight you can leave with peace, with God's presence. Jesus said, he who sins becomes the slave of sin, but if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. There's freedom to be found. Let's surrender our hearts to God tonight. How many here? Slip up your hand. Say, Pastor, pray for me very quickly. You came in. Maybe you didn't understand everything the Bible says about prophecy and the end times and all that was here, but you do understand that there's no peace in your heart. You're not saved. Amen. Young person, older person, slip up your hand, say, that's me. I'm not saved. Or maybe you're backslidden and you served the Lord. Temptation came, you fell. Amen. The important thing is not that we fall. The important thing is that we get back up and move forward. Amen. There's healing. There's deliverance. God heals the backslider. Can we pray for you? Slip up your hand. Say, that's me. I want to get right. I need Jesus. I'm not where I need to be with him. Pray for me this evening. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then we're going to take a minute to open the altars. And hallelujah. God knows our future. When we commit our way to him, when we trust in him, when we surrender to his will and purpose, he's strategically able to place us like he did Daniel and That's not just for a few people. That's for God's people. Commit your way to him, the scripture says, and he will direct you. Maybe there are people here, God has spoken to you about being prepared. You have stirrings on the inside, and God's given you a vision, given you a burden, a desire. Now is the time to prepare, to be ready for when he does call us. When the door does open, to make sure we're good to go, we're ready and willing to go. Let's stand together, amen. Let's take some time, find a place to pray. Let the Spirit of God help us and minister to us as we worship God together. Stay where you are. I want you to pray. Just say, Lord Jesus, here am I. And God, I commit my way to you. And like you did with Daniel, I'm asking you to direct my steps into your perfect will for my life. Help me to be ready, to be prepared. Lord, let me embrace these qualities of speed and not procrastination, but to lay hold of what you have for me, and ferocity to be strong and not allow hell to run rampant over my family and my home and my life. And Lord, help me to have visionary leadership and to move with that leadership and to have that vision and be that leader in my home, in my family, and in my church, that I might lead, Lord, people into your perfect will through discipleship and exampleship. Help me to be that instrument that you use to make this world what you desire it to be. In Jesus' name,
Hallelujah. God, I'm asking right now, God, that you would challenge, you would equip. I'm praying you would speak. God, you would give vision, Lord, to your people, that you would speak to hearts, a word in season. God, that you would bring a calling. God, that you would affirm that, God, in the hearts of your people, that they would feel that burden. God, that calling, that divine directive, God, to be your people in this generation. God, I'm praying that you strengthen your people, God, in this day and hour. God, help us to be Daniels. Help us to be people in a troublesome world to rise, God, and be a shining light. And God, we believe you for that, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Lord praise, can we? Father, we just bless you. We do believe you, God. We thank you for the mercies of God. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Our brother Joe Romano, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. God, we ask that your spirit go with us in this place. We pray that you back to next time. Lord, we pray. Lord, teach this word, seal it for our hearts. Go with us in this place. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Spirit, touch your church.